Alleluia, Christ is risen. He is risen indeed. Alleluia. Welcome to our online worship from Advent Lutheran in Solon, Ohio. We are so glad that you're tuned in with us today. And we pray that this time of worship will be a blessing to you. We're going to start off with some celebrations and concerns like we normally do here from our members from the past week. If you have other celebrations or concerns to share, feel free to share them using the chat feature. We are recorded ahead of time, so we can't insert those into the prayers, but you can. And we're going to give you time to do that today. So be sure to share those with one another so that we can be celebrating and praying with you a bit later and throughout the week ahead. Let's start off with a celebration. Mr. Ballant, who many of you know, is celebrating his 96th birthday this week. And it would be awesome if we could shower him with phone calls or maybe notes that you send to him during the week. If you need contact info for Mr. Ballant, reach out to me either by text or email, and I'll get you set up. Galen, thanks everyone for their prayers following his recent knee replacement, and he's happy to report that he is doing very well. He also asks, though, for our prayers for the family of Bob Nance. Bob, a former Advent member, passed away this past week, I believe, or at least very recently. Let's also add our prayers for Jill. Jill, I was scheduled to do Jill's wedding on Saturday, and unfortunately and shockingly, her husband-to-be Mike Kish suffered a heart attack on Thursday morning, and he passed away. So please do keep Jill and her family in your prayers also. I'm also sad to report Karen Bryant said that one of her friends passed away, or a friend of their a family member of one of her friends passed away this past week as a result of COVID-19, which reminds us, of course, that we do have many prayers concerns related to the crisis that we are in. We pray especially for all those who are dealing with illness at this time, whether that be from COVID-19 or other complications. We know the stress that maintains and the difficulty of being with those who are hospitalized at this time as well. We pray for the medical workers who are caring for them, both in our hospitals and in our long-term care facilities. We pray for researchers who are working to find treatment and vaccine so that life can get back to a little bit more normal feel to what we are looking for. We continue to pray for those who are struggling at home, either with depression or abuse, or just or loneliness. And God, we ask that you would continue to support them, to help them through this time of social distancing, provide them with the support that is needed. We pray for all those who have lost jobs during this time as a result of the crisis and bear additional stress and hardship because of that. We also do want to celebrate and to rejoice in the successful surgery for one of our members, Lois, who we were praying for this week. Her surgery on Friday went spectacular. She is recovering well, and we pray that that recovery would be full and without complication. Today in worship, we are going to have a lot of fun because today is the type of service we call an access service. Access provides a turning point for us. It provides us with an opportunity to focus our whole attention on one topic. And so we've been sharing throughout this year by the bucketful. And today we're going to be talking about sharing new life by the bucketful. But the other thing that turns an axis is that axis is the time when most of our worship, let's be honest, focuses on adults. And the kids get to come along and they get what they can out of it. But Axis, we focus on kids. And so today, all through the service today, we're going to feature the kids of Advent. We can't get you all in there, but we've got a bunch of the kids of Advent that have contributed to putting this service together. And I want to thank them so much for that. I also want to say a big thank you to our Axis musicians, to Bruce and Lori, to Hannah, for coming alongside of me to help make this music a little more full, a little more vibrant, and a little more fun this morning. So thank you for helping to record all of these songs for us today so that we can sing and enjoy a wonderful service. And since we know that if this service is focused on kids and kids like to keep things moving, let's say we get started right away with our first song, Lord, I Lift Your Name on High.
Lord, I lift your name on high.
Hey, everybody. So one of the things that we do at Axis, that we always do at Axis, is we always play some games. We play games because kids learn by playing and, well, because games are just lots of fun. And so today we have to do this a little differently because, as you may have realized, we can't be in the same space for this game. But never fear, our kids have come through in a big way, and this is going to be lots of fun anyway. So we asked our parents earlier in the week to videotape their kids cracking, peeling, and taking a bite out of a hard-boiled egg. And the parents have sent in the videotapes of their kids racing each other to see who could do this the quickest. And now we get to see how all of that comes together and who's really the fastest in the great egg race.
Thank you.
Okay, wow, that was fun. And if I might say, I think Zaire was probably the first to put his egg into his mouth. But hey, you were all really fast. And with all of those people doing it at the same time and the speed of each of you cracking, peeling, and eating those eggs, my goodness, you could tell you all deserve a prize. But it does get me to thinking, you guys were all in such a hurry. It was a race, and we race ahead, and we try to get through things as quickly as possible. We try to get to the end, to the big payoff at the end. And it's hard when we're not fast enough, or when the end doesn't come soon enough, or when we're just not sure when that end is actually going to happen. We're all in one of those places right now where we have to wait. We'd love to rush ahead. We'd love to say, hey, let's get there as quickly as possible. But no matter how fast we run, no matter how hard we work, no matter how quickly we move, we can't get to the end of the race we're in any faster. The race we're in ends when Jesus comes. When Jesus shows up for us, and when Jesus says, now is the time. And so we wait. Keep that in mind today as you listen to the lessons, because I think you'll hear about a man named Thomas in our gospel today who had to wait for something that was mind-blowing. Boy, it must have been hard for him to wait, but boy, was it worth it when he did.
A reading from Acts. But Peter, standing with the 11, lifted up his voice and addressed them.
Jesus of Nazareth, a man attested to you by God with mighty works and wonders and signs that God did through him in your midst. As you yourselves know, this Jesus delivered up according to the definite plan and foreknowledge of God, you crucified and killed by the hands of lawless men. God raised him up, loosing the pangs of death because it was not possible for him to be held by it.
Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
A reading from 1 Peter. Blessed be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. By his great mercy, he has given us a new birth into a living hope through resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, and into an inheritance that is imperishable, undefiled, and unfading, kept in heaven for you, who are being protected by the power of God through faith for a salvation ready to be revealed in the last time.
In this you rejoice, even if now for a little while you have had to suffer various trials, so that the genuineness of your faith, being more precious than gold, that though perishable is tested by fire, may be found to result in praise and glory and honor when Jesus Christ is revealed. Although you have not seen him, you love him, and even though you do not see him now, you believe in him and rejoice with an indescribable and glorious joy. For you are receiving the outcome of your faith, the salvation of your souls.
Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God.
The Gospel according to John.
Glory to you, O Lord.
When it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and the doors of the house where the disciples had met were locked in fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." After he said this, he showed them his hands and his side. Then the disciples rejoiced when they saw the Lord. Jesus said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so I send you." When Jesus had said this, he breathed on them and said to them, "Receive the Holy Spirit. If you forgive the sins of any, they are forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they are retained."
But Thomas, who's called the twin, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. So the other disciples told them, "We have seen the Lord." But he was said to them, "Unless I see the mark of the nails in his hands and put my finger in the mark of the nails and my hand in his side, I will not believe."
A week later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them. Although the doors were shut, Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas, Put your finger here and see my hands. Reach out your hand and put it in my side. Do not doubt, but believe. Thomas answered him, My Lord and my God. Jesus said to him, Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have not seen and yet have come to believe.
How Jesus did about. Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book, but these are written so that you may come to believe that Jesus is the Messiah, the Son of God, and that through believing you may have life in his name.
The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Wow, kids, that was amazing. Thank you so much for putting together those readings. Thank you, parents, for helping them with the videotaping of that so that we could hear your amazing job reading God's word for us today. What a treat that is. It's always a treat to hear God's word and to be part of the story of God. And that is no exception today as we celebrate together this second Sunday of Easter. The second Sunday of Easter always features the story of Thomas, or Doubting Thomas, as so many have taken to calling him. But I really think that there's more to Thomas's story than just that he's a doubter. Thomas, like most of us, wanted to experience Christ, wanted to know that Jesus wasn't just a story that was for that others could tell him, but that Jesus was real and could be felt and experienced and touched and part of his own life. Thomas wanted to know that when he put his trust in Jesus, he was putting his trust in more than a story. He was putting his trust in a person who had overcome the grave, a person who was alive, a person who could come to him, who could help him, and who could lead him on the way. Boy, don't we all want that? And don't we all have trouble sometimes believing that? Thomas did, the other disciples did, and we do. We all have those doubts, but they come to us and Jesus understands them. What a joy to know that Jesus understands our needs and is willing to meet us where we're at. He's willing to come to us and to help us to come to belief, to trust him, and to lead us to be his hands and feet in the world. Well, kids, you did an amazing job reading those stories, but I think it's always fun at Axis when we get to do more than just hear the story. We get to see the story. After all, isn't that what Thomas just said he wanted? He didn't want to just hear about Jesus. He wanted to see Jesus. Well, let's see if we can help you out a little bit with that. I've asked some other of our young people to share with you the story of Thomas in a little different way. You might recognize some of them, but we thank them for their help with this service, and I hope you will enjoy their rendition of Thomas.
Hey there, Thomas. Where you been tonight?
I've been outside to catch evening light.
You should have been inside. You should have been with us. The Lord came by and created quite a fuss.
Came by here? Came by here? Don't you think that's kind of crazy? Don't you think that's rather weird?
What makes you say such things, Brother Tom?
I wasn't born yesterday. I've been around. Corpses don't come back to life. They never leave their grave. And this one's been sealed up tight in a cold and musty cave.
But don't you remember what Jesus said? He said the grave wouldn't always be his bed. He said he'd come back to life. Remember his words?
But that was before the Romans came with their clubs and swords.
But he meant it, Tom. What the woman said was true. The only one who missed him was, I'm sorry, you. We were all inside, a bit afraid tonight.
I wouldn't believe unless he stood before my eyes. For all I know, that's just a pack of lies.
Wait a minute, Thomas. What's bugging you?
Good old Peter here is trying to cheer me up. But he shouldn't make up a bunch of stories to do it.
What did he say?
Some nonsense about Jesus coming to visit our humble abode.
But it's true!
Now you're doing it too!
So I am, but I can't help it. I'm a happy man! Jesus came back today. It's really true. So why not be happy, Tom? I'm asking you.
I can't believe. Don't you understand that? Stop trying to make me feel like such a lousy rat. You got to see him, or so you say. Well, if that's true, he'll be back someday. And when he does, I'll be here to see. So I'm sorry, that's just the way it's gonna be. I'm not gonna believe every story I hear. For all I know, you guys have been drinking beer. If I see, I'm going to believe. If you don't like that, you'll just have to leave.
Boy, what's wrong with you anyhow? We're not making up stories. What we've said is true. We thought you'd be glad to hear. Tell me, what does it take to convince you?
Yeah, Thomas, how can we persuade you that everything the woman said this morning happened?
Look, fellows, I know you've done your best, but a joke is a joke, and a jest is a jest. Don't you think it's dangerous standing out here? If the Jewish elders catch us, they'll have our hide. Don't you know they're after us? They want to catch us too. They'd be glad to string us up right out in public view.
Is that what's got you, Tom? Are you still afraid? Out to save your skin from being filleted? It's all over now, like being free. Tried as they can, they can't catch me. The Lord is risen. He is risen indeed. That's the good news. That's our new creed.
Self-delusion. Something to live for. Make it worthwhile.
What are you mumbling over there?
Nothing. Nothing at all. It's not important.
Sure it is. Sure it is. Everything matters now.
How so?
Well, now that he's back to life, the jig is up. Just as he said the night he passed the cup, his body and blood were shed for us to forgive our sins and free us from all fuss. The world is God's. It can't get rid of him.
But the light has flickered. It's gone awful dim. Don't you remember Friday, how they pounded those stakes? Just a few hard blows, that's all it takes. Blood dripped down, it flowed like wine. That's when my hope withered, right on the vine.
We can understand that, Tom. We felt the same. For just a few hours, the world had gone insane. We thought it was over then, just like you. We returned home in quite a stew. But haven't you heard a single word we've said? He's come back to life! He's no longer dead!
Unless I see in his hand the print of nails, and place my finger in the mark of nails, and place my hand in his side, I will not believe.
I guess that's it then, isn't it?
I'm afraid so. Is it really so difficult to comprehend? Natural laws don't so easily bend. Call me a skeptic if you think I am, or if the labor's doubter, then I'm your man. I think I'm enlightened and rational. A theory needs proving to be actual. So bring me some proof, and then I'll know. Some clear-cut evidence that you can show.
You're like so many other people today. Give me evidence is all they say. They think they're sophisticated, clever, and wise. They only believe what they see with their eyes.
Are they really that odd? Tell me, why do you believe? The last couple of days you've been filled with grief. Isn't it simply because you too have been given proof? Tell me, how would you be behaving tonight if, contrary to what you say, Jesus hadn't come into your midst?
You've got a point.
You bet I do. The only difference between me and you is that I haven't seen him risen yet. In fact, if you're willing to make a little
bet— Wait a minute, Tom! We're getting nowhere, and neither one of us is being fair. we'll just have to wait, and that's all we can do, and hope that something will satisfy you.
Don't hold your breath.
8 days later, his disciples were again in the house, and Thomas was with them this time.
Well, what you say, fellas? It's been over a week.
If I were you, Tom, I'd be careful how I speak.
It's just the same. It's now the 8th day.
Don't be so smug. Watch what you say.
I've been hanging around here just marking the time without any reason, without any rhyme. Don't you think it's time to leave? Go back to Galilee? See our friends and even family? Nothing's going to happen. It's rather clear. We're wasting time sitting around here.
Oh, come on, Tom. You promised you'd wait and stick with us. We're not letting you out of our sight. Next time, you're going to be with us.
I can only hope the Lord will come back soon and show you, Tom, how you're being a buffoon. The greatest stubbornness I've ever heard. You know, Tom, you've really been a nerd.
Okay, that's enough. Cut it out. We can't help if he wants to live in doubt. But I do hope we can show some courtesy, patience, kindness, and love, if need be. The Lord wouldn't want us carrying on like this. He said by love we'd show we're truly his.
Okay, I promise to cut it out, if you all will.
It's a deal.
The doors were shut, but Jesus came and stood among them and said, "Peace be with you." Then he said to Thomas,
"Thomas, I've heard every word you've said. Did you really think that I was still dead? I know how weak your faith can be. So come on over. Come closer to me. Do you see my hand? See the marks still there? If you need proof, then it's only fair to give you all that you want and take up your dare. See the wound where they pierced my side? No, don't turn away. There's no place to hide. Place your hand inside it if you so choose. Go ahead. You've got nothing to lose. And do not be faithless, but believing."
"My Lord and my God!"
"Have you believed because you have seen me? Blessed are those who have never seen me and yet believe."
That's what Jesus said to Thomas that day. The words were passed to us, and here's what they say. We have no proof. We're left to faith alone. But that's nothing to gripe about, nothing to bemoan. In fact, we're more blessed than they, if we keep the faith right up to the last day.
Now Jesus did many other signs in the presence of his disciples,
which are not written in this book.
But these are written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing, you may have life in his name.
The end.
Wow, that was a fun story, and so much more fun to see it come alive right before us. A little Dr. Seuss-ish in some places, but hey, who doesn't love a Dr. Seuss book? I'm sure Jesus loves Dr. Seuss just as much as the rest of us. So, thank you again for that fun rendition of Thomas's story, and I hope that it helped you to see again just how much this story of Thomas relates to us and to everyone. You see, when we call Thomas Doubting Thomas, it often comes across like he's the only one that has these doubts. The reality is that the disciples, all of the disciples had their doubts. In fact, at the end of Matthew's gospel, even when Jesus is there and commissioning them, when he gives them the Great Commission as we know it, it tells us in Matthew 28 that they worshiped him, but some doubted. While they were worshiping, some doubted. And so they all have doubts. Even when Jesus is right there with us, we can still have our doubts. But Jesus meets us. This is what I want us to see about Thomas today, is that Jesus is not deterred by our doubts. He comes and he meets us where we are. He also invites us to experience him in community. Isn't it so interesting that Thomas who missed it on the first day, stays with the disciples, and the disciples help to keep him there, to urge him to not miss out the next time that Jesus shows up. You see, because when we just go about our lives on our own, we might miss those moments when Jesus really shows up. We need community to help us to see what Jesus is up to. Our community as a congregation is about helping one another and helping others to know that God is present here and active and at work for them and through them and around us all. Jesus is alive. And while today, just like Jesus said to Thomas, blessed are those who will believe and have not seen, we don't get the opportunity to see Jesus in the same way that Thomas did. I know we would love to do that, but Jesus has given us a different plan. He's actually called for you who believe the story from Thomas, who believe the story from the other disciples, who believe the stories that have been told to you by your parents, by your church, to experience the presence of Christ in the way that we serve one another, in the way that we come together, in the way that we worship this Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ, the one who reigns over death, the one who shows us new life, the one who overcame the cross and the grave, and who comes now even to overcome our doubts. This same Jesus is the one who drives us forward. He's called you and me to be bearers of his word. Our children have read God's word today. We've sung praises to God's name in the songs that we've sung. We've prayed together, and we will do some more of that in just a moment. We've seen this story come alive. Our children have shown us Jesus in ways that help us to comprehend, to really grasp this truth that Jesus meets us where we are. But you know what? The way that Jesus wants to meet others who have doubts about him in our world today is through you and I. The Apostle Paul always talked about the church being the body of Christ. That's what Thomas needed to see. That's what so many of us need to see. To have our doubts removed, we need to see people, real living people, acting, working, living like Jesus. That's what the church is called to be. That's who we are called to be. And so when we serve others, when we reach out, when we show them our scars that we have taken on for the sake of others, when we show them that we are willing to step into their own doubts and to meet them where they are, when we say, it doesn't bother me that you're having trouble with this. I want you to stay with me until you get it. This is the church. This is Jesus. This is how we meet the so many more that are out there, just like Thomas, who need to see the living Christ present for them. Jesus has said, you can be that Christ. We together, we are the church, and the body of Christ lives to meet others where they are, as they are, and to call them to new life. Praise be to God that we get to share this new life by the bucketful. Today we're going to do our prayers a little differently than usual. We're going to sing a song that we often use at our Axis service. It's a version of Jesus Loves Me, combined with Amazing Grace and a whole lot of Alleluias. We'll start with the Jesus Loves Me verse, followed by a chorus of Alleluias. But then, instead of moving right along as the song usually does, we're going to insert our prayers. I'll lead us in a prayer, and then at the end of each of the prayers I offer, I'm going to give you space to add your own thoughts, your own words, your own concerns, your own thanks, your own ideas, to add your voice to the prayers. These are the prayers of the people, and so there'll be space for you to pray together, to pray with those you're with, or if you're watching alone, to know that when you add your voice to the prayers in this service, God hears them together with all of God's people in this worship and throughout the world. We are united in prayer, and we come together to pray today. Each of those three times of prayer will work like this. The first one will be about giving thanks for all that God has provided. The second is about lifting up the needs and the concerns, the people that we have on our hearts, that God places on our hearts today. And finally, the third petition is about praying for the church, for God's body at work in the world. How will the church and God's mission be supported and continue to be called out for the sake of the world? We're going to pray for the church and God's mission in the world today. So after that third time of prayer that you have, we'll conclude the song with a verse of Amazing Grace and a final chorus of Alleluias. And in between each of those petitions, we'll sing another chorus of Alleluias. Don't worry, we'll lead you through as we go. You'll know that it's time to wrap up your prayer and to join us in singing Alleluia when you hear me say, "We sing Alleluia." Let us pray.
Jesus loves me, this I know. The Bible tells me so. Little ones to Him belong. They are weak, but He is strong. Oh, alleluia, 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 alleluia.
The disciples rejoiced when they saw you. And though we do not see you with our eyes, we believe that you are with us always, just as you promised. Lead us to give thanks and to rejoice for your presence among us. Hear us as we give thanks to you. Sing Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Time of need, and we trust you that you will do the same for us and for those on our hearts today. Hear us now as we lift up the people, the concerns, and the needs we hold today. We sing Alleluia.
Hallelujah. Alleluia.
As Thomas insisted on seeing your body with him to believe, you have called us, the church, to be your body for the world today. Hear us as we pray for the church's mission in our homes, in our neighborhoods, and throughout the world. We sing Alleluia.
Alleluia.
Praise and thanks to you, Holy God, for by your word you made all things. You spoke light into darkness, called forth beauty from chaos, and brought life into being. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks and praise. By your word you called your people Israel to tell of your wonderful gifts, freedom from captivity, water on the desert journey, a pathway home from exile, wisdom for life with you. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks and praise. Through Jesus, your word made flesh, you speak to us and call us to witness forgiveness through the cross, life to those entombed by death, the way of your self-giving love. For your word of life, O God, we give you thanks and praise. Send your spirit of truth, O God. Rekindle your gifts within us. Renew our faith, increase our hope, and deepen our love for the sake of a world in need. Faithful to your word, O God, draw near to all who call on you. Through God the Father, the Holy Spirit, and Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord, who taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever and ever. Amen. Hey everyone, just a couple of announcements to share with you. Of course, check the website adventsolon.org and this YouTube channel throughout the week for new content and new information as it becomes available. Keeping the focus on kids, we have craft kits available here at the church entrance. You can come in the first set of doors. The second set of doors remains locked, but those first set of doors are open so that you can get inside and grab a set of craft kits. Those are open from 9 a.m. until 7 p.m. daily. Pick one up for each of your kids. We'd love to see, and be sure to send us pictures of some of the stuff that they're making at home or the other things that you're doing in your home during this time of distancing to keep sharing the story with one another and with the world. Speaking of our kids in Sunday school, we've got, parents should have received on Friday Sunday school materials to use in the home with your kids this week. So if you didn't get that, reach out to Dana by email or text, and we'll be sure to send that to you again. Dana also sent in an email to all of our parents information about some Zoom check-in times that we've set up for our older kids' Sunday school classes. If you have kids in the youngest group, below third grade, and you're interested in that, again, reach out to Dana by text or by email, and we'll see if we can get something set up for your kids and their teachers as well. But this week, on Tuesday at 7 p.m., from grade 6 to 9 can check in on Zoom with one another and with their Story Life Sunday School teachers will be on there with them. Also on Thursday, our 3rd through 5th graders, you'll have that opportunity. Thursday at 7, 3rd through 5th graders, check in on Zoom with your Story Life Sunday School teachers and one another. We hope that'll be a good way to continue to build those relationships that are so important. Speaking of Zoom groups, we've also set up some new Zoom group options for adults. So if you're interested in a virtual coffee hour or parenting conversations, or you're interested in just some time to check in with one another over a devotion, or you want to do some Bible study with a group of adults, we've got options for all of that and are developing more all the time. To let us know about what you are interested in, go to adventsolon.org/Zoom groups, and Zoom groups is all one word, so no spaces, and that'll take you to a form where you can let us know what kind of group you'd like to be a part of, and maybe if you'd be willing to host one of those groups. So let us know on that. Our adult Story Life class is still happening, and that happens every Wednesday at 7 p.m. on Zoom as well. So look for the login info for that coming out on Tuesday so that you can get set up to join us for our Wednesday 7 p.m. adult Story Life class. Finally, just don't forget to keep sending in those offerings. We're so thankful for your support during this time that we are apart. You've been so faithful, and we pray that you continue to do that throughout this time. So send those in by mail, or get set up to do online donations. You can set those up either as one-time donations or recurring offerings. And those will work not only now, but throughout the time. And you have control always over changing the amounts, the frequency, and so forth. So a really simple way to keep on top of your giving commitments and what you want to, the ways that you want to support our ministry here at Advent. To set up online giving, just go to adventsolon.org and click on Give. And thank you again for your support and for being part of this service. We're just about ready to wrap up, and let's do that now as I invite you to receive our benediction.
May the God who raised Jesus from the dead bring you to new life, fill you with hope, and turn your mourning into dancing. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.
I know he
in my soul. His blood has covered my sin. I believe. I believe. My shame is taken away. My pain is healed in His name. I believe. I believe. I'll raise a banner.
Go in peace. Serve the risen Lord. Thanks be to God. Alleluia. Alleluia. Alleluia.